Hola, and welcome back to reinforcement learning tutorial number 2. Here we're going to talk about how reinforcement learning agents learn to act. You should have an intuition now from tutorial 1 for how dopamine might implement a reward prediction error to learn future expected value. But how does the brain use expected values to learn how to act? Let's remember from Doina's lecture this morning, a policy is the formal description of how an agent chooses an action based on the observed state of the world. And a fundamental problem with learning how to act is exploration versus exploitation. We're going to talk more about that in a moment. Finally, when you have states and actions, you need to use a representation of value that can inform your policy, or an action value representation, if you want both the value function and the actions they produce to produce the optimal behavior. So, back to our schema for how an agent interacts with the environment. In this case, an agent will take an action. The environment will return the new state and the reward associated with it. And over time, the agent can update its action values to estimate the future value of the action that was taken in the state. We normally study this using something called an unarmed bandit. It's an analogy to going to a slot machine where you have a bunch of one-armed bandits and you get to pull each of the slot machines, and sometimes the slot machines are better and sometimes they're worse. In this case, let's imagine a machine that has multiple arms, in this case, blue, red, and green. Here, if we choose the blue arm, we are going to get more value every time we take that action. If we choose the green arm, we're going to take less value every time we get that action. And if we choose the red arm, we're going to get something in between. But let's imagine we just chose once and then decided whether we knew which was best. If we choose the red arm, we don't know whether it's the best. If we were to explore, we could try all of the arms and then figure out which one is best. If we imagine that these might be slightly noisy so that on every time we make a selection, we don't always get exactly the average value, this question becomes even harder. Fundamentally, the question of how to explore and exploit is very tricky. Let's imagine the sort of optimal scenario. If we knew how long to explore until we knew the best set of values, we could explore for a period of time and then switch to exploiting, that is, choosing the best action forever. However, this is almost always computationally intractable in the real world. Let's take the other extreme. Let's imagine we're normally going to exploit or be greedy, but some small fraction of the time, epsilon, we're going to choose just randomly. This would ensure that we continue to explore, and over time we would eventually learn what actions were best. We could be a little bit more sophisticated and try to combine these ideas by doing something where we take a large epsilon or more exploratory behavior at the beginning, and then we allow it to decay over time, becoming more exploitative. If we look at the percentage of actions taken by an epsilon greedy policy over a series of episodes, we can see that when epsilon is zero, we're very likely not to find the best action. In this case, it was something like 30-something percent of the time. However, if we have an epsilon that allows us to explore 10% of the time, over the course of these plays, we end up finding the optimal action 80% of the time. And at the same time, this reflects on the average reward that you will receive. So in this particular example, having a larger exploration bonus means you more quickly converge on finding the highest average reward. So, how can we think further about mapping reinforcement learning to the biology? Well, we already learned that dopamine, which is in the VTA and S&C, probably represents reward prediction error, and it projects heavily to the striatum and also to cortex. We think the cortex is likely involved in state estimation and perhaps generating actions, but it's the striatum, or the caudate and putamen in primates, where we think action values or state values live. So let's look at an example of what might be an action value neuron. So in this study from Lau and Glimcher, a monkey had to choose between a red and a green dot on a screen, and they would shift their eyes or take an action to look at it, and then they would get a reward. It was either a large or a small reward, and it was with a probability, so maybe it was 30% of the time. And in blocks, these change, so the animal had to continually learn. So if you estimated the preference that the animal had in each of those blocks for one side or the other, you could estimate the expected action value that the animal had. And if you look at the spike rate in ocular motor caudate neurons, what you find is that they very directly, almost linearly reflect the action values. Now, we were talking about exploration and exploitation. Is there a neural signature that might tell us that we know when we're thinking about exploring? Well, in a classic study done by Nathaniel Daw, he actually used something that's really quite like an unarmed bandit task, where subjects were pulling arms on virtual bandits on a screen, and the payoff of these bandits drifted over time. That meant that the subjects had to keep track of which arms they had not checked recently. And if they did this correctly, they would be able to go and check to see if they had gotten better. When looking for neural signatures that correlated with exploratory behavior, they found activity in the frontal pole. So this suggests that we may actively control how much we are exploring or exploiting. So in exercises 1, 2, and 3 today, you will use an unarmed bandit to study action value representations and to build an intuition for the exploration-exploitation trade-off. In exercise 1, you will implement the epsilon greedy policy. In exercise 2, you will implement an action value update function. And in exercise 3, you will explore how different values of the exploration parameter epsilon and the learning rate parameter alpha affect how well the agent learns. Good luck!